Musicians and listeners alike have always been interested by the descriptive or evocative power of music. No one has really been able to explain completely why certain musical ideas will bring feelings or images to mind. Sometimes this evocation is not the primary purpose of a work. No matter what the listener's reaction may be, the architectural design may be the element the composer wished to emphasize. On the other hand, a great deal of music has been written in all periods which is literally descriptive in intent. This is usually divided into two types. First, program music, in which an actual narrative is musically described. And second, a type of music that we may call pictorial, which evokes objects, sensations, or states of mind in a more general way without a dramatic plot. Beethoven's Sixth, or Pastoral Symphony, belongs to this latter pictorial kind of music. Each of its five movements bears a title indicating what we will hear. The first is called The Awakening of Happy Feelings on Getting Out into the Country, and begins like this. Passage illustrates a method Beethoven uses a good deal in this symphony to evoke the calm atmosphere of a summer landscape. That is, the repetition of a short musical figure. A contrasting aspect of this rural evocation brings in a small bit of the theme you heard open this movement. That is paired with a new rhythmic figure for winds. The following complete passage results. The process of repetition I mentioned before that last passage appears in a different form in connection with a later theme. This theme is actually made of two melodies continuously repeating themselves against each other. One is broad and rich, starting in the cellos. The other is a gentle, flowing figure in the violins. Together, they sound as follows. Watch for the repetitions. It is hard to say concretely why this repetition produces the bucolic effect that it does. Similarity to the simple, repetitive sounds of woods and fields is probably the closest explanation. Beethoven remarked that this symphony contained more of feeling than of painting, however, and it would be useless to look for a too literal imitation of the sounds of nature in this movement at any rate. In a final new theme, the wind instruments obscurely suggest rustic pipes and horns, although here again they are not imitated literally. This fades away in another short, repeated figure. This general method of musically evoking the feeling of the country has remained a model for similar undertakings ever since Beethoven wrote this symphony. another of the methods used by Beethoven in the Pastoral Symphony to create rural moods is illustrated in the development section of the first movement. That method consists of superimposing one kind of rhythm upon another. The violas and cellos are given this repeated figure. The violins, at the same time, are given another repeated figure made of a different rhythm. When the two are played together, they produce a murmuring effect like leaves in the wind. In the second movement of the Pastoral Symphony, called Scene by the Brook, Beethoven's pictorialism becomes somewhat more specific, although for the most part there is still no direct imitation of natural sounds. At the opening, the motion of water, perhaps, is suggested in the string accompaniment. Against this, the violins are given a short, repeated figure. It is interesting to see how Beethoven subtly varies this theme in its many appearances within this movement, both in its melodic outline and in its orchestral dress. In a later episode, only the murmuring accompaniment remains the same. The melodic figure is given to the clarinet and bassoon. And a new element is added, a delicate, almost bird-like trill in the violins. When these elements are reassembled, this is the result. Still another version of the theme, not only its orchestration, but its melodic shape as well, is changed. At this point, I should like to touch upon some of the backgrounds for the sort of pictorialism we have been hearing. Both the 17th and 18th centuries had their well-established methods of musical illustration. In France, particularly, this tradition was very strong, that nation produced some of the greatest music of the Baroque period in the form of pictorial keyboard pieces with whimsical titles. Couperin's Nightingale in Love is a case in point. Later, in the 18th century, musical illustration took a form a little closer to Beethoven's methods. A cantata called The Morning by the English composer Thomas Arne, who incidentally was the author of the song Rule Britannia, contains imitations of birds typical of the period. Seen that Beethoven, up to this point in the Pastoral Symphony, has not attempted any such direct literal imitation of nature. The emphasis has been upon moods, evocations of feelings. Toward the end of the second movement, however, the scene by the brook, he inserts a series of imitative bird calls and even identifies the birds in the score. There are three. First, a nightingale, represented by the flute. Next, a quail done by the oboe. And finally, the cuckoo in the clarinet. These are all played together with the following result. The tradition of musical imitation of the sounds of nature is very much alive today. Bartok, for example, in his third piano concerto, creates an eerie, nocturnal atmosphere in which the sounds of birds and insects are unmistakable. As I have remarked, most of the evocations in the Pastoral Symphony are of a very generalized sort, and even when Beethoven decides to imitate nature directly, it is in a purely pictorial way in the 18th century sense. That is to say, there is no narrative or plot that governs this music. Later on, however, composers became very much interested in expressing musically the progress of actual plot structures. Berlioz, for example, based his famous Fantastic Symphony upon a story he invented about a young man who, having taken a nearly fatal dose of poison, experiences a series of visions, which are the five movements of the symphony. Later still, Richard Strauss attempted even more direct musical representation of narrative. In his symphonic poem, Don Quixote, for example, Various adventures in the hero's mad career are illustrated quite literally. In his symphonic poem, based on Nietzsche's Zarathustra, Strauss carried this idea to its final extreme by attempting musical description not only of a narrative, but also of the philosophical ideas of the literary original. In any case, Strauss and Berlioz illustrate in their separate ways the idea of program music, which follows a plot, and its distinction from the pictorialism, or simple musical description, that Beethoven undertook in his Pastoral Symphony. The third movement of the Pastoral Symphony is called The Happy Reunion of the Peasants. For the first time, Beethoven brings people into his landscape. The musical evocation of this takes the form of a theme in two parts. Here is the first. And here is the second. Various treatments of this double theme culminate in a joyous climax. A new theme, intricate and intriguing in its rhythm, contrasts completely. A later section suggests the heavy steps of a peasant dance. The three movements of the Pastoral Symphony we have considered so far follow the regular order of the classic period, an opening fast movement, a slow, expressive one, and a contrasting movement, which in Beethoven's symphonies was called a scherzo, a fast dance-like piece. Customary procedure at this point would have been to pass directly into the fast final movement. In the Pastoral Symphony, however, you will have noticed that the first three movements have been quite calm in general, with relatively few strong climaxes. Beethoven at this point evidently felt the need to add an extra movement with qualities of high excitement to form a sort of dramatic focal point to the work. Accordingly, he interpolates a fast dramatic movement between the scherzo and the finale, and in this fourth and extra movement, he presents us with a musical representation of a thunderstorm. In it, as you will see, he returns to a more literal sort of description, closer in method to the imitative bird calls of the second movement than to the generalized mood evocation of the first and third. The fourth movement opens with distant thunder and the sound of the first large raindrops of the approaching storm. The storm suddenly breaks in full force. There, Beethoven gave us a graphic representation of bolts of lightning. The height of the storm is described in the following way. There are many famous orchestral thunderstorms which derive from this model. A good example is the Royal Hunt and Storm episode from Berlioz's The Trojans. The Storms of Life episode from Liszt's symphonic poem Les Preludes is another, although actually its intent is the description of a state of mind rather than an actual thunderstorm. In the Pastoral Symphony, the storm recedes with a few final rolls of thunder and a flash of distant lightning. This leads to a hymn-like melody. Rural pipes and horns open the last movement. This last movement carries the title, Shepherd's Song, Happy and Thankful Feelings After the Storm. Its theme is as follows. This theme, suggesting the fresh, clear feeling in the air following a thunderstorm, is one of the most beautiful evocations in the literature. It is difficult to say concretely how Beethoven did it. The strongest factor, besides the simplicity of its melodic and harmonic nature, may be its rather special instrumentation. The violins are written in a high register at some distance from their accompaniment, sounding like this by themselves. They are accompanied by sustained wind chords and plucked strings. Together, as you recall, they sound like this. Listen for the high, pure sound of the violins over the other instruments. The last bit of that theme gives rise to a contrasting passage. The last new theme you will hear is this. These ideas are the musical material out of which the last movement is built. In summing up the symphony, Beethoven subjects the main theme of the movement to an almost fugal treatment, or one in which different voices answer each other with the same musical subject as they enter one by one. This procedure creates a sense of anticipation leading to climax that is needed to bring off the conclusion of a work of the Pastoral Symphony's dimensions. There is an important quality about this work which so far in our discussion has only been implied. This is that in evoking the countryside in this way, Beethoven has not only created a musical landscape, but has also paid nature an affectionate, perhaps even a religious tribute. There are close parallels in literature. Recall Wordsworth's famous poem, Lines from Tintern Abbey, written at almost the same time. Therefore am I still a lover of the meadows and the woods and mountains, and of all that we behold from this green earth, of all the mighty world of eye and ear, both what they half create and what perceive, well pleased to recognize in nature and the language of the sense, the anchor of my purest thoughts, the nurse, the guide, the guardian of my heart, and soul of all my moral being. This feeling that moral solutions and ethical systems exist in nature is an outstanding characteristic of the period, and can be seen as the real beginning of Romanticism. In the closing pages of his Pastoral Symphony, Beethoven reflects this sentiment in a hymn-like treatment of the main theme of the movement. Finally, a muted horn recalls the opening of the movement.